my mind. It's a conversation that took place between a husband and a wife. The husband said to the wife, "All that is yours is mine, and all that is mine is yours." The wife says, "No. All that is yours is mine, and all that is mine is mine." I don't want to speak about that this morning, but today I call this Sunday the In-Between Sunday. And please allow me to speak for a moment on the unknown or the uncertainties of life. The unknown or the uncertainties of life. Let me remind you that Thursday was Ascension Day. And the Ascension is the departure of Christ from earth into the presence of God. The disciples will see him no longer in bodily form. He was gone from them. The lesson read as our first lesson in Acts chapter 1, verse 6 through 14, paints the picture for us. Jesus had been raised from the dead. Jesus has been appearing and disappearing among them. And now he takes them to this mountain. Listen to how Dr. Luke puts it. The one who writes in a sense of a chronological order. Then they gathered around him and asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? The same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." You can read the rest. But the first declaration I want to make is that Jesus has not returned yet. Because this passage promises us that when he comes, we will see him in the same way that he left this earth. And if he had come and gone, what are we doing here? There will be no church. But the question is, what do we do when we come to the end of the road in our lives? Let me paint the picture for you that might help you in terms of the uncertainty. Jesus was crucified. That shattered their hope. What? They nailed him to the cross. That was discouraging for them. Some of us have been when a situation of dependence suddenly comes to an end. For some of us, a crucifixion took place in the family. The breadwinner is suddenly taken away. And all seems lost. It's death or a job we were confident is going to be there for a long time. Suddenly we are given a pink slip or the job disappears. Or we are told a position no longer exists. Death for us. Crucifixion. Misery. Or for many years we have enjoyed good health. We've been healthy. And for the first time, we sit in our doctor's office or by the bedside of someone we love. The doctor says there is no hope. Crucifixion takes place at dying, not to set men free, but a place whereby we are helpless. But then the disciples' misery was transformed by something strange that they did not understand. Jesus was raised from the dead. Wow! They were now seeing him. They were observing every time he came through the walls when the doors were locked, or by the lakeside, or in the different experiences of their lives. When resurrection comes to us, resurrection transforms us from misery, from the unknown to the unknown, because we become filled with power, as Jesus promised them in the first reading. No, the kingdom will not be, Israel will not be restored, but you will receive power. But they have seen him, and now he is standing with them. He was again in their community, and they loved it. How we love to be together as a church, because we believe that in the building Jesus is there. But no, he goes with us. But the account in Acts presents another difficult moment in the lives of the disciples. As they were talking with Jesus, he was taken into heaven. What do you do when the rubber hits the road? Tomorrow seems bleak. And in fact, you don't even want to possibly wake up tomorrow because it looks so uncertain. What do you do? When we come to the end of our resources, when our energy is totally depleted, our imaginations cannot solve the problems, and our dependence seems non-existent, what do? It seems like a dark tunnel through which we have to grope. But let's look at the reaction of the disciples. They were there. The robber hit the road for them. It was uncertain for them. They did not know what to do next. They could not find an answer. It's unknown. First, they were hopeless. In other words, hopeless in the sense that, well, what do we do now? And in fact, we are told they were still looking up into the clouds. And you know, if you're trying to have a good view of something and the clouds seem to move, you tend to adjust your position so you can see what is beyond the cloud. Because between the cloud and the blue sky back there, there is a gap. So they are looking and they are seeing Jesus going, 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 and they say, oh God, what's happening to us? You've been there, no, sir? When you found yourself like, you know, I'm zapped of all my energy. I don't know what to do. But one of two things happens to us when the rubber hits the road. Our hopelessness either leads us to despair or to memory of things that have gone or we've heard about. We are never without a choice. The first reaction was to keep looking into the sky. I don't know whether they were prompted by the thoughts of Psalm 121, verse 1, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills. From whence cometh my help? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Now it's possibly they were looking up with a sense of hope. They were looking up because he's been taken up, but I will lift up my eyes. This time not to the hills, but to the sky. Was this a posture of hopelessness and despair? Possibly. Possibly they are bereft of thoughts. What do we do now? What's next? Then two men dressed in white, came to them and made a promise. Why are you still looking up in the emptiness of your life? Why are you looking up in the places where you can find nothing? Why are you still holding on to what you can't hold on to? Then he makes a promise, this same Jesus, that you have seen go will come back in like manner. Please note, the dependence on a promise is usually relied upon based on the testimony of the past. Let me help you out. If you have a friend who always tells lies, if they tell you stand here, you go in the next junction, not so. You move into the next room. But Jesus was speaking to them. He's left them. The angels of God that spoke in good news about God before is now in their presence. They relied upon the past fulfillment of promises. I believe that once these men spoke, they remembered what Jesus had said in the past. I will not leave you comfortless, but I will come to you and I will be with you. Like God had promised that as I was with Abraham, with Moses and Isaac and Jacob, so I will be with you. I will neither leave you nor forsake you. Their memory is juggled. And most times in the emptiness of our lives, our memories become alive. They remembered. They remembered possibly the words of the prayer read in the gospel. All that are yours are mine. They remember the words of Jesus that he says to them, I will be with you even to the end of the age. They remembered. They remember Jesus praying for them and praying with them. They remember Jesus raising the dead. They remember Jesus healing the sick. They remember Jesus feeding the hungry. When our bleak moments come, when we remember the testimony of God, we are energized and we can move on. What do we do with our uncertainties? I want to suggest that they hoped for God to do something. The expectation to receive what is to come is birthed through the promise of the past that was already fulfilled. Faith calls into being what is not yet. Hope gives us a vision of what we are to attain. So immediately, they hoped for what is beyond. So we see their reaction. Go back to the room where Jesus had appeared to us. He's gone. Let's be together. Let's be together because we know that we are together. We die together, we live together. You know, situations of despair normally makes the sheep and the wolf to live in the same tent. Did you know that? There's a story that is told about some flooding that took place some years back. And out of nowhere, they found a fox and a goat sitting on one rock, holding to each other. They were both praying, but their prayers were different. The fox is praying that the rain will stop and will have his dinner. The goat is saying, God, please, don't let the rain stop. Because as long as it's rained, I'm safe. And I believe these guys are saying, as long as we are uncertain, we don't know what to do, let's hold on together. Let's embrace each other. But there is a promise. Our faith is inspired when we get to the place of our best experience with God, when our memory kicks in and says, yes, I was in this place before. God was faithful, and God will be faithful again. So they went to that room to pray and to wait, not to live in total hopelessness, but to live in the presence of great expectation. So what are the lessons that we can take home with us this morning? I'm glad you asked. Number one, things that are seen are temporal, but things that are unseen are eternal. Amen? The physical absence of Jesus must lead them to faith and lead us to faith and dependence of the promise of God. The promises that Jesus made whilst he was with them. I believe this is what has kept the church going for so long, the testimony of the words of Jesus himself, that those who believe that he came from God, he died, are saved. That's the testimony. That, I believe, is what continues to stimulate the energy within the church. So we cannot compromise the history and life of Jesus. He came into the world, he lived, he died for our sins, and then was buried and rose again and lives victorious and is coming again. Number two, we must constantly set our hearts and our minds on things that are above. In Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 to 4, the Bible tells us, since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated in the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on things on earth. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. My friends, nothing in this life lasts forever. All we hold on to, we would have to leave behind, but what is stored up in heaven is for us, awaiting us in glory.
Amen.
So we find that nothing in life lasts forever. Anything that is birth needs to die. But death is not the end. There is a glorious resurrection. And above all, there is a glorious reuniting with those who have gone to be with the Lord and us when we get there. Number three, when all fails, when we are in this uncertain moment, the unknown, when everything else seems to fail, one thing works: prayer. Amen? So when email fails, email works. Let me say that again just in case you miss it. When email fails, email works. When we get into the places of uncertainties, when we get to the unknown, when we have nothing to offer for our desperate situation, when we fall on our knees, God, in a mighty way, pours down upon us his strength. And even though the situation may not change, God empowers us to move to the tomorrows based on his strength. Unknown situations might lead us to despair, but on our knees, God raises up to the place of hope and trust. When we come to the place of the unknown, instead of despair, we must get into prayer. For in prayer, God will help us to get into the rest of life. Because tomorrow never comes. I'm reminded about a guy who has been longing for a bottle of beer. He has no money and he keeps moving on until he gets to a kiosk. And on in front of the kiosk was this inscription: free beer tomorrow. Came back the next day. He read it, it says, free beer tomorrow. Tomorrow is not promised. And it is a place of unknown. And right here on this Sunday, we are in the in-between period. Jesus was taken away from the disciples. But next week is an exciting moment. Wait, and you will receive power of the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send to be with you. And if you want to hear that message, come on Sunday.